Welcome, geniuses. I'm Genie, your best buddy for A-levels. In this channel, we'll bring you to explore the secret formula behind success. Hello, geniuses. Our guest today wants to be introduced as Random Dude, because he's just that random, I think. The following are a list of things that he wants me to tell you that he loves. 1. Playing Ultimate Frisbee. 2. Watching and following Formula 1. 3. Watching anime. And most importantly, because he put it in all caps, Iron Man was his childhood idol, inspiring him to want to study engineering.
Hello everyone, my name's Aldrick, and I'm studying engineering at Jesus College, the University of Cambridge.
So, Aldrick, as random as you may be, what will you say to students who are just about to begin writing their engineering personal statement?
The most important part of the application process is no doubt your personal statement, and it will take up a huge chunk of your time. So don't rush it. Think about it before writing it. The best idea sometimes comes at the most unexpected times. So what I would advise everybody out there writing your personal statement is to be as honest as possible. Remember, the personal statement is about yourself, not about other people. So whatever you write about it, make sure to relate it to your own experiences and your own passion towards that particular subject. For example, for engineers, you can write about a certain project that you've done and how you applied various skills that you have to achieve the goals that you want. Or perhaps a certain subject, a certain topic that you've done extensive research on and how those things that you've learned will be applicable to making you a better engineer. Another key thing to remember when writing a personal statement is that if you have an interview coming up, they would surely ask something regarding a personal statement. So whatever you write in there, make sure that you actually understand the particular stuff that you've written in there, or you have personally experienced it. You really don't want to be in a position where you are caught off guard for writing something that you have actually not experienced or something that you actually haven't learned. So remember, they don't really expect you to write like you are the best out there or saying that you have actually learned a bunch of stuff regarding engineering. They expect you to be just yourself and tell your story to them, and I'm pretty sure that they'll be inspired by your story as well.
In your opinion, what are the common mistakes that students make when writing their personal statement?
One of the most common and major mistakes, which are easily avoidable, are spelling errors and grammatical errors. So all you have to do is actually proofread through your whole application and double check it before you actually submit it. You really don't want your application to be like really, really good already, but just those few errors which cost you a place in university. Another major error is that a lot of people likes to boast about their achievements and list down as many competitions or activities that they've done before. In a sense, I think that that would hold some value as well, because you sort of show that you have time management, you are willing to spend your time in various competitions and experiments to show that you have the passion towards your course. However, I think it's way better to actually reduce the amount of activities that you've actually done, but elaborate more on it. What have you learned from those activities? What have you experienced? What skills you actually applied to help you to achieve your final goal? By illustrating these various concepts to the reader can actually understand that, oh, you're actually someone who has the ability to go further and beyond and actually have the motivation to achieve what you want. I think that's a way more valuable topic to explain to your readers. Another major issue that I realized that happens to a lot of people, especially those applying to Oxbridge, it includes me myself, is that we like to tailor-make our personal statement and our entire application towards those particular universities. There's nothing wrong with that, but bear in mind that getting into a good university or even Oxbridge isn't just everything. You have 4 other choices. You have 5 university places that you're supposed to apply to, and your personal statement should be able to cater to all 5 of those universities. You never know when you need your backup plan, right? So it is best to just be yourself. Write an all-encompassing personal statement, a general personal statement to cater to all universities, and just show off your passion and the skills and your talents. It's all about the potential to go further and not about what you've done, so just bear that in mind.
How can we go about showing passionate engagement with the subject?
So this is a topic that a lot of people struggle on, including me myself at the beginning. In the end, what I managed to do is to explain my experiences in robotics competitions. How did I use my various skills and talent and passion to actually work towards a certain goal? Another thing that I did was to illustrate that I actually watched a lot of YouTube channels and learned a lot from them. For example, Real Engineering, Kurtz Kazak, and Tribu One Brown. Those channels are usually maths and science channels, and including some general knowledge as well, because it's important to actually expand your horizon beyond the syllabus. Another thing that I find most people doing, but I didn't do it myself, is actually read a ton of engineering books. Just keep in mind that engineering books are really dull. They have a lot of mathematics inside of it, so if you don't really have the patience to read through it, it's kind of pointless, to be honest. But there is a great reading list for budding engineers out there, which is by Cambridge University. So it's a Cambridge Engineering recommended reading list, and I encourage you to check it out. Maybe you'll find a book that you really like and you can finish it. Another thing that you can do is to actually illustrate how you relate your A-level subjects, the concepts that you learn, the skills that you've gained towards your particular degree or course that you're aiming for. That's if you don't really have anything else to talk about. Other things include, like, you know, perhaps you participated in an online course about certain skills, or maybe you learned some coding in your free time. Inspirations are everywhere to actually illustrate how you are passionate towards your subject. It's endless. So good luck in finding that yourself.
I've heard a lot of people say that coding is an essential skill to get into university for engineering. From your experience, was that indeed the case?
Bear in mind, if you don't really have those skills, it's totally fine. I didn't have it either. So just go all out in explaining your other ways to actually illustrate your passion. Another few ways to actually show that you know coding or are in love with coding is to actually do some small projects or participate in some small competitions or do some questions in certain websites. For example, kaggle.com or leetcode.com. And another one is probably build a website for yourself, maybe design some portfolios. Just be creative and write it down in your personal statement. It certainly helps.
You mentioned utilizing YouTube channels and websites to aid in your learning process. Could you list a few examples?
So like I said, a really good way to actually illustrate your passion is that you show that you learned a lot of stuff outside the syllabus and actually explain those stuff within your personal statement. So one of the ways that I did that was by watching a lot of YouTube channels. So one of the YouTube channels, my favorite YouTube channels, is Tribu One Brown. They actually explain really in-depth certain mathematical concepts and sometimes science concepts as well. And they have these amazingly animated videos, and it's really, really intuitive for you to understand it. Another one is Kurtz Kazak, where they don't really dive into the specifics of the maths and science, but gives you a general overview of a certain problem. For engineers, it's really important for us to understand how our problems come about and certain existing solutions that we have, and how are we supposed to improve upon it. This is a really important point that you can point it out within your personal statement. So Kurtz Kazak has really nice animated videos and a really amazing voice actor. Another few websites that I actually like is Khan Academy, where I can do some questions and improve certain concepts over time. And another YouTube channel is Minute Physics, where I learn more about certain physical concepts that can help me in problem solving. Another website that I think at least you really have to take a look at is iwanttostudyengineering.org. So this website is really, really important because it's a database of engineering questions developed by Cambridge professors, and it's really useful in general, like improving how you solve problems, as well as preparing for the interview, especially Cambridge interviews. Bear in mind that these practices aren't really compulsory, but it does give a slight edge towards your interview process or your personal statement as well.
Was there any particular reason you applied to Cambridge? And what were the other universities you applied to at the time?
I think a lot of people underestimate the process of actually selecting the 5 universities you want to apply to. So there are a multitude of certain aspects that you have to consider before applying to a certain university. For me, what I considered was the location, the university's prestigiousness rankings, certain accommodation facilities that they have, as well as the cost of actually going to that particular university. And for engineering specific universities, I would consider about the certain facilities they have in terms of the engineering labs and whatsoever, the modules that they actually provide, as well as the industrial experience they provide for during the engineering course. The 5 universities that I've actually selected to go to is Cambridge, Imperial, UCL, Manchester, and Southampton. Another thing that you really have to think about is give a concrete reason of why you want to go to that particular university. It is best to not just only look at the rankings of the university, despite it being important. So my reason for actually going to Cambridge University is because we have 2 years of general engineering before actually specializing in your particular field. Personally, I value that a lot because I believe that engineering is a multidisciplinary subject and it is important to understand other engineers as well before actually being able to understand your own engineering discipline. So I'm pretty sure that with in-depth research and by exploring certain websites, for example, thestudentroom.com, you can actually know more about the university that you intend to apply to and provide concrete reasons to anybody who asks you, especially during the interview.
Tell us a little about the entrance test that you had to take and how you went about preparing for that.
So I took the engineering admissions assessments to get into Cambridge Engineering, which is called ENGGA for short. So it has two papers inside and it's fully multiple choice questions. But the only problem is that you are not allowed to use any calculators. Yeah, you heard that right. No calculators allowed. So the main point of this particular assessment is to actually test if you can calculate stuff and be able to identify certain shortcuts to do certain questions in the least amount of possible time. What I would advise everyone to do is to actually practice a few weeks ahead without using any calculators when you're calculating your maths questions or your physics questions, and do tons of practice. You can find past papers in the Cambridge Engineering website, and if that's not enough, because I think they only have like 4 papers in their website, you should probably try the BMAT questions as well. Within BMAT, they have maths and science questions, so make sure to check that out. Always practice your papers within the given time limit because it's really important that you not just get the answer, but you actually have to get the answer fast. And not a lot of people can actually complete the whole assessment paper. So it'll be great if you do, to be honest. But of course, don't put too much pressure on yourself and just try your best within this assessment, because this assessment isn't about competing who's the best, but they actually have a threshold. As long as you pass that particular threshold, you'll move on to the next stage when they consider your application.
We all know interviews can be scary. How can applicants better prepare themselves for the interview process?
So for this question, I'm just going to divide it into 3 parts where I talk about how I prepared my interview and then how did my interview go and how I dealt with the results of my interview. So first of all, it's about preparation. Preparation is the utmost importance for an interview. What you can do is actually prepare and anticipate certain questions that the interviewer would ask. One of the easiest questions to anticipate is, why do you want to study engineering? Why do you want to apply to Cambridge or Imperial or certain universities that you actually are applying for? Another question that they will surely ask is something related towards your personal statement. Bear in mind that they will not be so unreasonable to the extent that they ask you something that you did not write in your personal statement. So whatever you do before you get into the interview, spend an hour or two to actually read through your personal statement and find out what you still don't understand within it. Or perhaps revise certain topics that you actually written down in your personal statement. For example, I've written down that I really like lasers and I went for an internship in a laser company. So what they asked me during the interview is about how certain lasers are modulated and how they produce their pulses. So I really had to read in depth those theories and certain subjects regarding that particular topic that I've written about. So those questions you should prepare beforehand so that when you get into the interview session, you can actually answer it smoothly without any hitches. Interviews are usually technical, especially for engineering interviews. So what you can do is do plenty of practices with various engineering questions. And bear in mind, those practices, the answer is not the most important part of the whole process, but how you think about the question, how you arrive to your solution, that is the important part. So whatever you do, whenever you prepare for the particular interview, just make sure that you can think out loud. Prepare with a friend if you can. That's the best way, in my opinion. You can just take out engineering questions from Isaac Physics and iwanttostudyengineering.org and actually start discussing about how you are going to approach to this question, what physical principles that you might apply, what equations you might apply towards it. Always do the revision of your A-level syllabus before you actually get into the interview. Because bear in mind, the interviewer, again, wouldn't be so unreasonable to actually ask something beyond the syllabus. They will ask questions that are really, really tough and really push the boundaries, the limits towards your knowledge and application towards what you have already learned within A-levels. During my interview, what I did was to actually calm myself down. Remember, being calm about it is one of the key aspects to actually having a great interview. Unfortunately, my interview wasn't great. I got a little bit nervous in the beginning, and I didn't manage to get two questions right out of three questions that I was asked. But nevertheless, I still got in, so it shows that the answer isn't really the most important part of the whole interview process. It's how you think about it. Think out loud. Whatever you want to do, whatever you want to say, whatever you want to write down, just tell the interviewer what you're thinking. And bear in mind, don't be afraid to ask prompts. These interview questions are designed to be hard, and usually the interviewer expects you to ask a question too. Of course, having said that, don't ask like 5 different prompts throughout the one particular question. That's a bit unnecessary, and it shows that you don't really understand what you're doing. At most, probably ask 1 or 2 prompts, and if you really still can't get it, ask the interviewer to give you some more hints or maybe guide you through the entire question. So after my interview, I didn't really deal with it that great. What I would advise applicants out there to do is to actually forget about it. What's done is actually done. For me, I was quite stressed out because I knew that I didn't perform that well. But after that, I calmed down because I remembered that I actually have another admissions test coming up. So it's important to focus ahead of what you actually want and not look back, because those mistakes that you've already made can't be undone.
Now, a lot of people suggest that applicants read more books. What are some of the books that you would recommend?
So in terms of engineering books, there's a really great list given by Cambridge University, which is the Cambridge Engineering Recommended Reading List. For budding engineers out there, you can definitely read those books. But like I said, engineering books are really dull, and they are really, really mathematical. So make sure that you really have the patience and real interest to actually read those books. For me, I didn't really like reading those books. So instead, I read other types of books, which is concerning world problems and as well as certain economical problems that we face in the world today. As an engineer, like I said, it's actually really essential to understand the problems that we face right now so that we can develop solutions to counter those problems. One of the great resources to actually find more books about these problems in the world and certain solutions that are developed for it is Gates Notes. Gates Notes is actually a platform by Bill Gates, and it's his own personal blog, which he will publish recommended reading lists every single year annually by himself, as he has already read those books and gave certain reviews for it.
What do you wish you had known before you applied?
One of the things that I really wish someone told me before actually going through this whole application process is not to stress about it. If you view it as life and death situation or the greatest moment in your life to actually get into the university that you want, it actually stresses you out, and being stressed about it doesn't really help your performance.
And finally, do you have any last piece of wisdom that you would like to impart upon audiences before we end today's video?
What you should do is actually treat it as a self-discovering process. So discover what you're passionate in. Why are you doing the particular course that you want? And explore various knowledge that you haven't found out even yourself. Take it at your own pace. What matters is that you're learning stuff and you're actually enjoying it. So make sure that you really enjoy this process. It's really a fun process. And looking back, you know, you wish that you could do it again.
Thank you very much, Aldrich. I'm sure applicants will find this very useful. Love you 3000.
All right. Good luck, everybody. Thanks, Genie.
That's all for today's video. If you're interested in more genuine sharing by other geniuses, please subscribe to our channel and don't forget to turn on the notification bell. Ding dong. Genie, we'll see you in our next adventure. Bye-bye.